Hey everyone, I'm Jeff A and welcome to a special post-flight 5 update. RGV aerial photography managed to complete a flyover as soon as the temporary flight TFRs were lifted. In this episode, we'll recap the flight and the amazing booster catch by the machine that is Mechazilla. We'll then take a look at the launch site and finally move on to the remaining sites at Starbase Texas. Before we get started, we wanted to get this video out to you as fast as possible, so we've decided to split it into two videos. One analysing Flight 5 in depth, and one covering the flyover in depth. Be assured, we'll still be covering some flyover photos in this video, but stay tuned for our longer video in a few days from now. Starship Flight 5 featuring Booster 12 and Ship 30 lifted off from Boca Chica, Texas at 7:25 AM Central as SpaceX continues to iterate towards a fully operational launch vehicle. With only 5 minutes remaining in the launch window, the full stack would pass directly through the T-minus 40 second hold point on its way to liftoff. All 33 Raptors on B-12 light and appeared to perform nominally throughout all phases of flight. Looking down from Ship 30, at T plus 1 minute and 52 seconds, we see the engine plume as it expands in the upper atmosphere preparing for hot stage separation. At T plus 2 minutes and 32 seconds, the grid fins on Booster 12 rotate in preparation of hot staging with most engine cutoff at T plus 2 minutes 34. Ship engine startup happens at T plus 2 minutes 41 seconds, and we see Booster 12 drift away from the ship before relighting the inner ring of 10 engines to begin the boost back burn, returning it towards the launch site. At T plus 3 minutes and 3 seconds, we see side-by-side views as all the center 13 engines on Booster 12 return it towards the launch site, and Ship 30's 6 Raptor engines propel it on its way towards splashdown in the Indian Ocean. At T plus 3 minutes 31 seconds, we would see the shutdown of the ring of 10 Raptors on B-12. 10 seconds later, the boost back burn would be complete with the center 3 engines shutting down. Through the cheers of the crowd at Hawthorne at T plus 3 minutes 46 seconds, the flight director would make the highly anticipated call of flight director is go for booster return. While we wait for Booster 12 to finish its coast phase back to the tower, Ship 30 would give us its first views from one of the new flap cam locations looking toward the starboard aft flap with the Earth in the background. This flight would not give us any onboard view of the hot stage ring jettison, however we can see it drifting away from the ground track camera at T plus 4 minutes and 38 seconds. We also see the vents firing to control the booster trajectory. At T plus 5 minutes, the booster makes a 40 second maneuver that notably changes its trajectory following hot stage ring jettison, with the vehicle passing directly through the venting near the engine section. At T plus 6 minutes and 8 seconds, we would return to the ground tracking view just as B-12 passes by the plume left from the initial ascent. The aft section of the vehicle is noticeably showing heating from the speed of re-entry with a glow under the engines. With the tower still nowhere in sight from this view, at T plus 6 minutes and 30 seconds, the landing burn would ignite the 13 gimbling engines as the booster rapidly approaches 1 km in altitude at over 1000 km per hour. 7 seconds later, the landing burn reduced to just 3 engines for the final approach. A double sonic boom would follow at T plus 6 minutes and 42 seconds, just as we would get our first return to launch site view of the tower and booster. Residual flames were seen from the engine bay and the quick disconnect panel, as Super Heavy Booster 12 had no other choice but to attempt the once unimaginable. The 3 gimbling center engines fighting back against the 15-story tall booster as the chopsticks began closing from their initial approach position at T plus 6 minutes and 45 seconds. Passing through the chopsticks, the arms would begin their final closing move just as the chimes passed by, contacting the booster just below the forward stringers and coming to rest perfectly on the lift points. At T plus 7 minutes, the call out, Mechazilla has caught the booster, would be spoken for the very first time. Booster 12 held up to the forces well on this flight. As it approached the tower, we were able to see that one of the chines had lost parts of its covering, with the frame still attached. We saw during the initial approach to the tower that the engine bay was appearing quite hot. When asked by Marcus House about potential damage, Elon responded by saying that the outer engine nozzles experienced some warping from the high heating and aero forces. Once caught by the chopsticks, the engine bay appeared to exhaust dark smoke for quite some time, as well as seeing debris fall from the booster. The fire seen around the engines from shutdown may have ignited some of the shielding or components in the area, but it appears that the damage was fairly minimal. You can see in this flyover photo that B-12 still had a frost line on both tanks, leading us to think it landed with quite a bit of excess propellant. Ground cameras would later capture the booster being lifted onto the OLM and reconnected to the BQD. We'll elaborate more on the reasoning behind this in the next video. Back to the flight. With Booster 12 hanging from the chopsticks, we can't forget that Ship 30 is still making its way halfway across the planet. While the broadcast team was left nearly speechless, Ship 30 would continue with the shutdown of its three vacuum Raptor engines at T plus 7 minutes and 59 seconds, and its three sea level engines 30 seconds later. At T plus 10 minutes and 30 seconds, the broadcast would take a break while we continued to receive uninterrupted onboard views from the various cameras aboard Ship 30 throughout the remainder of the flight, reaching apogee at approximately 212 kilometers. At T plus 35 minutes and 5 seconds, Ship 30 would begin to maneuver in preparation for re-entry with all its flaps pulling back as it began to move into a nose up and nose forward attitude as the ship coasts facing sideways. At T plus 45 minutes and 40 seconds, a slight glow would start to appear along the heat shield of the ship, followed by an initial call out of re-entry into the atmosphere just below 100 kilometers in altitude. 2 minutes later, Starship would pass through 85 kilometers, with callouts stating that the flaps now had control of the vehicle. At this time, we can see that Ship 30 is beginning to descend into the sunset as the oceans and clouds begin to get dark. The beginning of peak heating of re-entry would be called out at T plus 48 minutes and 59 seconds, just like Flight 4. Engine chill startup would begin at T plus 54 minutes and 7 seconds, with a white plume visible at the base of the ship while looking back from the port side forward flap. The buildup of plasma continues to shift the colours along the vehicle body. As Ship 30 continues its re-entry, passing T plus 56 minutes, it appears to be holding up better than Ship 29, moving out of the peak heating period and entering the maximum pressure phase of re-entry. It's here that we start to see the plasma buildup shift away from the blue and orange colours to just the orange glow with the sparks and streaks as the heat tiles encountered stronger re-entry forces. At T plus 57 minutes and 18 seconds, the first multi-view of flap cameras would be shown. While the two aft flaps would appear in great shape, the port side forward flap would not be so lucky, as burn through would be visible at the leading edge. However, the hinge area would look undamaged from behind. We would see the first damage of the starboard side forward flap at T plus 58 minutes and 41 seconds, with burn through happening at the hinge just behind the middle hinge point. Block 2 Starships have a relocated attachment point for the forward flaps that will hopefully improve the durability during re-entry. With the survival of the rear-facing camera on this flight as we pass through T plus 59 minutes, we were able to see tiles along the body of the vehicle starting to glow, and just a couple of minutes later this would begin to fade away as they passed the maximum re-entry forces. As the ship passes below 40 kilometers in altitude, the heat buildup in the vehicle would subside and the remainder of the flight would be in near darkness until the landing burn. Ship 30 would continue to rapidly slow below Mach 2 at T plus 1 hour 1 minute and 2 seconds, entering transonic at T plus 1 hour 3 minutes and 5 seconds, and finally starting its subsonic belly flop at T plus 1 hour 3 minutes and 30 seconds. The belly flop seen during the suborbital test campaign would continue until the landing burn at T plus 1 hour 5 minutes and 23 seconds, followed by landing in the Indian Ocean approximately 20 seconds later. The ship would then tip over into the ocean, exploding just after contact seen from a nearby buoy. Once the fireball diminished, the buoy was able to witness the aft of the ship above the water just as it began to sink below. In what appeared to be a nearly perfect execution of the Flight 5 flight plan, we will have to keep our attention to what the next step is for Starship. Will Flight 6 fly soon with Booster 13 and Ship 31, or will this flight test successes push SpaceX to wait for Ship 33 to be ready? Let us know what you think in the comments. And that's it for our recap of Flight 5. Look out for our in-depth flyover analysis video, which will be released in a day or two. This episode was sponsored by our Patreon and ex-subscribers. Consider supporting our flights to gain access to high-quality flyover galleries and show-and-tell analysis the same day we fly. I'm Jeff A, and we'll see you next time from 10,500 feet.